मैं आप सभी का इस बहुत ही इम्पोर्टेंट लेक्चर सीरीज में, जो कि आजादी के अमृत महोत्सव को सेलिब्रेट करने के लिए भारतीय कृषि अनुसंधान परिषद ने शुरू की है, उसमें आप सभी का हार्दिक अभिनंदन करता हूं, स्वागत करता हूं। जैसा कि आप सभी को विदित है, ये हर भारतवासी के लिए एक बड़ा गर्व की बात है कि हम लोग अपने 75 वर्ष पूरा करने जा रहे हैं और 15 अगस्त सन 2022 को हम लोग इसको, इस सीरीज को पूरा करेंगे, 75 लेक्चर की सीरीज को। इसमें सर मैं आपको बताना चाहता हूं कि हमने अभी तक 33 लेक्चर पूरे किए हैं और ये आपका आज 34वां लेक्चर है। और इस लेक्चर के लिए हमारे पास 3 प्लेटफॉर्म है, जो की पर्सन हैं विद वीडियो हम लोग इस प्लेटफॉर्म पर अलाउ करते हैं। एक हमारा है प्लेटफॉर्म ICAR75lectureseries.webconevents.com, जिस पर हम लोग करीब 10,000 की कैपेसिटी हमारी, वहां पर भी हम लोगों को, बहुत सारे स्टूडेंट्स को अलाउ करते हैं। और तीसरा लेविस टीम होता है, वहां पर भी हम अलाउ करते हैं। और इस लेक्चर सीरीज में सर मैं बताना चाहूंगा आप कि बहुत सारे हमारे कीनोट स्पीकर्स सर आए हैं इसमें, चीफ इकोनॉमिक एडवाइजर डॉक्टर कृष्णाला, हमारे बहुत सारे डीडीजी, हमारे इरी के, हमारे इक्रीसेट की डीजी महोदया और बहुत सारे की स्पीकर्स एफओ से, वर्ल्ड बैंक से, जिन्होंने इसमें लेक्चर्स दिए हैं। कुछ मोटिवेशनल लेक्चर्स भी हमारे हुए सर इसमें, जैसे सर एक सेकेंड अगर आप अलाउ करें, डॉक्टर महापात्रा की कॉल है सर। सर डीजी साहब भी ज्वाइन कर रहे हैं। तो सर इसमें बहुत सारे ये साइंटिफिक, पॉलिसी कनेक्टेड, मोटिवेशनल, हर तरह के लेक्चर्स हम लोग इस सीरीज में कराते हैं। और जब हमने निवेदन किया डॉक्टर मंगला राय साहब से, तो उन्होंने सहर्ष इसको स्वीकार किया। मैं सर आपका धन्यवाद करता हूँ इसके लिए। सर आपको सुनने के लिए बहुत सारे लोग बहुत उत्सुक हैं, आपकी जो एक जो आप एक ओजस्वी वक्ता हैं और जिस तरह से चीजों को पिरोते हैं, बहुत ही आतुर रहते हैं आपको सुनने के लिए। जैसा कि आप सभी को पता है, इस बार का जो नोबेल प्राइज फिजिक्स में मिला है वो 3 लोगों को जॉइंट मिला है, उसमें से एक है जॉर्जियो पारिसी, और उनको ये जो पुरस्कार मिला है वो कॉम्प्लेक्स चीजों को किस तरह से सिंप्लीफाई करके रखे हैं। अगर आप देखें थ्योरी ऑफ कॉम्प्लेक्सिटी, जिसको कि उन्होंने कई सारी जगह पर इम्प्लीमेंट किया है, उसके लिए उनको नोबेल प्राइज मिला है। उसी तरह से डॉक्टर मंगला राय साहब हमारे जो कॉम्प्लेक्स चीजें हैं एग्रीकल्चर की, जो बहुत सारी हमारी दिक्कतें हैं, बहुत सारे चैलेंजेस हैं, उनको इस तरह से सूत्र में पिरोते हैं और जिसके लिए वो जाने जाते हैं, इसके लिए सर सब लोग बहुत आपकी तारीफ करते हैं और बहुत अच्छी तरह से सर इसका इंतजार कर रहे थे। सर जो हमारे ऑडियंस हैं, इसमें हमारे वाइस चांसलर हैं, कई सारे वाइस चांसलर आप देखेंगे हैं, प्रोफेसर आरबी सिंह साहब हैं, और हमारे आईसीएआर के डायरेक्टर्स हैं, सीनियर कोलीग्स हैं, जो कि इस कार्यक्रम को डायरेक्ट वीडियो आपका सुन रहे हैं। मैं सर आपके बारे में सभी लोग जानते हैं, लेकिन फिर भी मैं थोड़ा सा सर लोगों को बताना चाहूंगा आपकी जीवनी के बारे में, आपके अचीवमेंट्स के बारे में। साथियों अब हमारे हमारे जो परिषद है, इसके डायरेक्टर जनरल और डेयर के सेक्रेटरी रह चुके हैं। गाजीपुर में साहब का जन्म हुआ 30 जून 1947 को। बीएससी एग्रीकल्चर गोरखपुर यूनिवर्सिटी से पास किया इन्होंने, एमएससी एग्रीकल्चर और पीएचडी बनारस हिंदू यूनिवर्सिटी, एक बहुत ही प्रेस्टिजियस यूनिवर्सिटी है, वहां से इन्होंने पास किया। कई महत्वपूर्ण पदों पर मंगला राय साहब सुशोभित रहे हैं, जैसे जूनियर प्लांट ब्रीडर आरबीएस कॉलेज आगरा में रहे, साइंटिस्ट S1 S2 सेंट्रल सॉइल सैलिनिटी रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट में रहे, प्लांट ब्रीडर कम ब्रीडर उड़ीसा यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर एंड टेक्नोलॉजी भुवनेश्वर में रहे, प्रोजेक्ट कोऑर्डिनेटर लिनसीड रहे, ओएसडी टेक्नोलॉजी मिशन ऑन ऑयल सीड्स भी रहे, असिस्टेंट डायरेक्टर जनरल सीड्स, असिस्टेंट डायरेक्टर जनरल पॉलिसी एंड पर्सपेक्टिव प्लानिंग जिस पर रहते हुए बहुत सारा कंट्रीब्यूशन साहब ने किया, डिप्टी डायरेक्टर जनरल क्रॉप साइंस एंड सेक्रेटरी डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर रिसर्च एंड एजुकेशन, मेंबर वाइस प्रेसिडेंट बोर्ड ऑफ गवर्नर इरी इक्रीसेट सिमिट, बायोडाइवर्सिटी बोर्ड रोम, आईआईएम बेंगलोर एटसेट्रा। वाइस चांसलर भी रहे साहब, जो कि सबसे प्रेस्टिजियस यूनिवर्सिटी है, सबसे पुरानी यूनिवर्सिटी है हमारी जीबी पंत यूनिवर्सिटी के, उसके वाइस। बहुत सारे अवार्ड्स साहब को मिले हैं, हमारे नास फेलो हैं मंगला राय साहब, और 16 यूनिवर्सिटी से ऑनरी कोसा डीएससी डिग्री मंगला राय साहब को मिली हुई है। बहुत सारे प्रोफेशनल सोसाइटीज के भी फेलो हैं, और इनका रिसर्च एरिया जेनेटिक्स, प्लांट ब्रीडिंग, सीड मैनेजमेंट, पॉलिसी एंड पर्सपेक्टिव प्लानिंग है। मैं सर आपसे निवेदन करूंगा कि आप अपना अपना जो लेक्चर है उसके लिए ये प्लेटफॉर्म यूज करें, और ये प्लेटफॉर्म मैं सर आपको देना चाहूंगा आपके लेक्चर के लिए। डॉक्टर महापात्रा साहब भी सर ज्वाइन कर गए हैं और वो इस सेशन को चेयर करेंगे। तो इस इन शब्दों के साथ सर मैं पुनः आपका धन्यवाद करता हूँ सर, और आपको आमंत्रित करता हूँ आपके लेक्चर के लिए।
डिस्टिंग्विश्ड डायरेक्टर जनरल इंडियन काउंसिल ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर रिसर्च डॉक्टर अग्रवाल, डिप्टी डायरेक्टर जनरल एजुकेशन प्रोफेसर आर बी सिंह जी, डिस्टिंग्विश्ड वाइस चांसलर्स ऑफ वेरियस यूनिवर्सिटीज, डिस्टिंग्विश्ड डायरेक्टर्स ऑफ वेरियस इंस्टीट्यूट्स, कलीग्स, फ्रेंड्स, लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, इट्स इंडीड अ ग्रेट प्लेजर टू बी हियर विद यू इन दिस वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट सेलिब्रेशन एज इट वॉज ब्रॉट अबाउट अमृत महोत्सव। ऑन दिस वेरी ऑकेजन आई वॉज लुकिंग बैक बिकॉज इन माई बायोडेटा इट वॉज मेंशन दैट आई वॉज बॉर्न इन 1947, the year of India's independence. So in the year of India's independence, the first Prime Minister of India, Pandit Nehruji, on the floor of the parliament mentioned, everything else can wait but not agriculture. What a importance and priority which was attached to the Indian agriculture, knowing fully well that this is indeed the backbone. And in 1948, Mahatma Gandhi ji, what did he mention? He mentioned, bread is the god for the hungry. These two statements are two great people, very clearly indicates how important is agriculture for our country. Please recall, a great India's independence decades back was going on in India, and His Excellency the President of India did mention. What was the statement? The statement was that two greatest achievement in this country, the first is food self-sufficiency and second is life expectancy. So food self-sufficiency, stand alone, at the same time it contributed to the second one, increase in life expectancy. Despite all the odds, colleagues, friends, ladies and gentlemen, you may recall food grain production went up 6 times, milk, meat, vegetable, fruits, all more than 10 times. Fish production went up by 15 times and egg production went up by 50 times after independence. What a great achievement. When I was mentioning egg production increased 50 times, if you look back to the compound growth rate which is available from 1970 onwards, 20% compound growth rate of egg production in our country per annum. And during 1997 to 2003, it was precisely 40.7% increase in egg production. I salute to all those who are engaged in agriculture research and development. The scientists of 114 research institutes of ICAR, 70 state agriculture university, now more than 700 Krishi Vigyan Kendras officials, and all those who are directly and indirectly associated deserve all the appreciation. The farmers of this country, the policy planners, because of their vision and hard work, this whole achievement was made. Friends, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, as I was mentioning, milk production more than 10 times. And if you write from 1950-51, if you calculate, up to 2019, it was 1,900% increase in milk production in our country, despite the fact that cattle population increased only by 24% and buffalo population increased only by 153%. 24% and 153% increase in cattle and buffalo, and milk production went up 1,100%. This great achievement was simply because of the technology, innovations, breed improvement, cattle management, healthcare, nutrients, etc., etc. If you look back to the fisheries sector, I mentioned 15 times increase. But if you look back from where initially much of the fish production used to come, it was marine fish production, which is almost static today. But out of 14 million tons of fish production, 10 million tons today is coming only from inland aquaculture. The sole contribution goes to the distinguished scientists and fisheries associated people who are indeed making production. Now, I'm so happy that in nutraceuticals area, the seaweeds, even the agricultural scientists have utilized. CMFRI has done a tremendous, and 19 nutraceuticals have been developed and brought to bear on our front. For all this, our citizens, our colleagues, our friends, ladies and gentlemen, you all deserve all the appreciation. But this is an occasion, a celebration. Amrit Mahotsav, what we call, is an occasion for indeed introspection. What is our potential and what we can achieve as we go along so that we continue to be able to feed and meet our requirement. If you look back to the importance of the subject, globally, food continue to be important. And the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations, in 1974, they had the first World Food Congress. Thereafter, the gravity of the situation was so much, but what was announced, where heads of state participated, they announced that we will take care of the 10 years. 10 years from 1974. Hunger will vanish from this planet. But what happened? About a decade back, 800 million people were hungry on this earth. Which figure? The figure is increasing. Maybe about 1 billion people by now are not having adequate food. And it is in this context that subsequent food congresses, which has taken place 1996, 2000, 2002, and it is going on and on. So the issue is, the problem continue to be critical, and therefore, today is what I would like to do. I will avail this opportunity to not deliver a very specific talk, Specific talk on crop improvement, I did deliver one on 23rd of October of the Indian Society of Genetics and Plant Breeding. Another specific talk on research, education, and extension and technology development, management of change, I would be delivering on 14th of November of this month in the second Agricultural Congress as a plenary lecture. But today I would be touching some of the generic issues. And I would be making some generic statements, which I believe could form deliberation and action if found appropriate. Now, where the problem lies? Agriculture is primarily natural resource based. And what happens today? 80% of natural resources owned by only 20% people of the world. And more interestingly, richest 1% people own 40% natural resources of the world. And unfortunately, 50% poor survive only on 1% natural resource. In India, the wealth, 73% of our wealth is concentrated only in 1% people. We are 17.78%, very close now to 18% of the world population. We have only 4.2% water of the whole world. We have only 2.3% land of the whole world. And on this, 5 to 6 times more intensity of our population on per unit land as compared to world average. 11% livestock of the whole world, and more than 50% of our land in agriculture is below. 85% people are with only less than 2 hectares of land. Now, this disparity reminds me the greater issue, the greater cause of the situation for which Food and Agriculture Organization is worried about, for which countries after countries are worried about. And this reminds me today, most of the problem reminds me the national poet Ramdhani Singh Dinkar, Jab tak manuj manuj ka sukh bhag nahi sam hoga, samit na hoga, ko lahal sangharsh nahi kam hoga. So the sangharsh has to be, in his own words, अब याचना नहीं समर होगा, संग्राम महाभीषण होगा. So there has to be a fight, and fight to the finish for hunger, poverty, malnutrition, and ensuring food and nutritional and environmental security, bringing much needed equity to the people at the national and global level. Now, as I said, we have only 4.2% land of the whole world. And out of 328.7 million hectare area under total area in the country, now we are having only 140 plus minus 2 million hectare area under cultivation with a cropping intensity of 150%. So that is the situation. Now, out of these geographical area, 121 million hectare, which comes to 36% of the total geographical areas, is eroded, degraded land. 47.7 million hectare is facing chemical degradation. 7 million hectares are saline alkaline soils. 25-26 million hectares are acid soils. You may recall Orisha, you may recall Jharkhand, you may recall northeastern states. You do anything and everything, but productivity can't be substantially enhanced unless and until you address these soils, and particularly the acidic soils of these states. And therefore, amelioration and amendments are not going to change, and therefore, uninterrupted varietal improvement and other measures will have to be resorted to address the concerns of these acid soils, where many of them are associated with our deficiencies, aluminum and boron toxicity, iron toxicity, and many deficiencies. About 49% of our total soils are deficient in zinc, indeed a very serious situation. And I recall in 2009, how much we have to pursue. And it is in this context that in 2009, cabinet passed and now zincated urea is available. Why this is available? Because this situation is going to be further aggravated and much more aggravated if it is not addressed too, because 65% of our soils will be deficient in zinc by 2025 by one of the estimates. As far as the boron deficiency is concerned, 33% soils are deficient in boron. Iron deficiency is 12% soils. Current use efficiency, the micronutrients used, because these nutritional imbalances, which is adversely affecting the soil health. Now you are doing all nitrogen, phosphorus, potash, some minor and secondary nutrients, EC and PK of these soils. But you are not doing in soil health, the soil biota. And we know very well that 80 to 90% biological processes are done by the soil biota. Soil biota, which is ignored, is indeed extremely important. Now coming to the huge efficiencies of these micro and secondary nutrients. Now in major, phosphatic use efficiency, 10 to 20%. Nitrogen use efficiency, 30 to 50%. Zinc use efficiency, 2 to 5%. Iron and copper use efficiency is 1 to 2%. And entirety and totality, the micronutrient use efficiencies varies from 1 to 5%. This would essentially be called upon to be addressed too. If we look back, we are talking of increasing the income of the farmer, not looking to the ground realities and changes which are taking place. My friends, when Green Revolution started in 1970-71, 1 kg NPK application used to give 50 kilograms of extra wheat. Today, 1 kg of NPK give only 5 kilograms of wheat. That's the situation because of the degradation, because of nutritional imbalances, because of the climatic changes and its manifestation. That 140 plus minus 2 million hectares is under cultivation since we became independent till today. Out of this total geographical area, 7% geographical area for which land use statistics is available at the moment is used for non-agricultural purposes. And in this non-agricultural purposes, each year we are adding 0.3 million hectares. Therefore, the situation is likely to be the population increasing. Since our independence, more than three times, area continue to be same, and 0.3 million hectares of total geographical areas is going to non-agricultural purposes each year. Therefore, measures will have to be resorted to. That is why I mentioned that I would be raising some generic issues. The land holdings, the fragmentation of the land holdings. In 1970-71, 71.01 million hectares land holdings were there, and now it is more than doubled. That's the gravity of the situation. At that point of time, the holding size was 2.28, which is now 1.14. Now below 2 hectare, 85.01% people, farmers, are there in agriculture. And one of the estimates, Dr. Birthel and his friends, from our anchor, based on the climate change. Climate is changing and about to change. But the issue is, should it change the way it is changing? Should it change with the same pace as it is changing? And if it is changing with the same pace, which is likely to be aggravated if you do not take corrective measures, then the estimates are that by 2035, pulses yield would be reduced by 25%, wheat by 22%, and rice by 15%, sorghum 7%, maize 4%, And as per their estimate, only rapeseed mustard yield would be little bit marginally increasing by 1%. Now in 40% of the wheat area, adverse effect would be pronounced enormously. And with 1 degree temperature increase, 2% more water would be required to maintain the same level of it. So one, nutritional imbalances, erosion, degradation, nutritional imbalances, and water use efficiency and problems, and water availability and totality is another major issue. The total fruit grain consumption, which is estimated, was 64% by in the year 2000. We were using our total intake for food, cereals, we were taking food grains 64%, which is expected to be 57% by 2025, and which is going to be about 48% in 2050. This very clearly indicates that with the same pace of growth, rice, wheat, you may be having less than 2% compound growth rate, but feed requirement, fodder requirement, because the acceleration in economy would be requiring much more animal-based protein. And therefore feed requirements, the core cereals requirements, production may require at the rate of about 5% compound growth rate. The water which I mentioned, there are very serious issues, not only on the use efficiency, but the groundwater. It is true that 9% groundwater is contributing to our product. But what groundwater is being pumped out and being used, 65% is going to agriculture. If you compare at the global level, be it USA or be it China, we are siphoning too much groundwater, and therefore situation in different aquifers are likely to be serious. In a state like Madhya Pradesh, we may recall, we might be very happy that we are producing good quality wheat, but the per kg wheat produced and the underground water used in Madhya Pradesh is highest in the country, and this would lead to a disastrous situation. Same is true in Punjab for rice and wheat cultivation. Please recall, there was a time when we were producing rice right in April, May onwards, where temperature used to be 40 degrees Celsius. Thanks with our report, I recall, late Dr. Sinha, late Dr. G.B. Singh, I was member secretary, productivity decline in Punjab and Haryana, myth or reality in 1998. And Vajpayee ji was the honorable prime minister. He was so happy that he asked 50 copies of those reports. And based on that report, green manuring and the shift area that nobody can go in April, May for rice, so that you take care of the water table. But if you look back with the current level of use in the Indo-Gangetic Plain, which is one of the greatest food security region in the country, now 755 billion cubic meter deficit would be there by 2030, maybe 9 years down the line. Therefore, it becomes indeed a very serious issue. Colleagues, friends, ladies and gentlemen, as I was mentioning, despite all these developments, if you look back to our PDS system, 800 million, 80 crore people are under PDS at the moment. If you look back each year, 2.43 lakh crore are being spent on PDS as per the Economic Survey 2021. If you look back to the figures there on, 21 people are below not only the poverty, but in extreme poverty situation. 15.2% people are undernourished. So despite the fact, as I mentioned, food self-sufficiency, the primary issue even today with these kind of production, I congratulate you again that in Corona, if one sector has given a positive result, it is agriculture sector. Again, congratulations to farmer and the scientists and developmental officials. Imagine if this could not have been produced, what could have been the situation of the PDS system? And that is why many times I have called and I would call again today that national security is important, but food security is an integral part of national security in India's context. Because we are 17.78% population, we have only 4.2% of water and 2.3% land. The tradable surplus which is available in the world market, please recall about 15 years back, when there was shorted price of rice and wheat has been doubled with a very short span in the global market. Therefore, cannot be left high and dry. But if we look back to investment, investment is important. As I mentioned, Pandit Nehru mentioned that everything can wait, but not agriculture. We are grateful. But what is the expenditure today? We must look into and we must introspect, because celebrations are the actual time of introspection. The research intensity ratio of India, research intensity ratio in agriculture is the expenditure in agriculture vis-a-vis the agriculture gross domestic product. And what is this? It is 0.3 in India. How much is in China? 0.6. How much in developed economies? More than 3. So research intensity ratio is more than 3 in the developed economies, where 1 to 10% people are engaged in agriculture. More than 50% people are engaged in India's agriculture. And we are spending 0.3%. 0.3 continue to be research intensity. To the recommendation, UN, we talk time and again. What is the recommendation of the UN for the sustainable development goals of zero hunger? They have said at least this research intensity ratio should be 1. So India is 1/3, which is recommended for the global level. Coming to the expenditure of the gross domestic product and gross national product which we are spending in India, despite the fact that more than 15% people, and even if your GDP agriculture contribution is 20%, more than 50% people are on 20% gross domestic product. So where is the equity? Where is the social justice? Where is the balanced and harmonized growth? But the expenditure of GDP which you are mentioning, 0.84% of the gross domestic product was highest in India. That was in 2008-09. And at that time, the GNP was zero. It was, the expenditure was 0.90% of gross national product, which continue to be the highest till today in percentage terms. But out of estimate, because I was looking to the Statistical Institute data, which was brought in the form of a compendium, 2017-18 data estimates are there that per rupee, how much expenditure is going in different areas. So out of each 100 rupees, DRDO is getting 37.84. Space is getting 16.61 and ICR is getting 11.37. I'm pretty sure this ratio has further gone down. So even whatever we are getting, the intensity research is 0.3. Gross domestic and national gross domestic percentage utilization, I brought to your kind attention. And how much is the allocation in different sector? DRDO and space put together, if I add, it is almost 55%. And the poor agriculture sector is getting 11.37%. What kind of priority is being accorded to agriculture research and development? Despite all these constraints, I bow my heads to the people, to the scientists. If you look back to their contribution in the last 2 years, 651 improved varieties of more than 50 crops have been brought about. And 70 out of them are fortified varieties. Many of them are fortified for proteins, vitamins, minerals, amino acids, etc., etc. Out of these 651, 451 varieties do have inbuilt resistance to, and many of them have horizontal resistance to, a number of biotic and abiotic factor, which is so serious at the moment. Again, I appreciate more than 1 lakh quintal of breeder seed, which is being produced each year, of more than 1,300 varieties, improved varieties of different crops and commodities. Out of these, more than 1 lakh, please calculate how much is the nucleus seed requirement and how much effort is going on and on. But how much is the conversion seed? How much is the conversion to certified seed? Because it is the certified seed which goes to the farmers. And if this conversion rate is too meager to make much dent, it is a colossal loss of the valuable efforts. And therefore, this is indeed a generic issue. The seed, sapling, planting material, and conversion of rates, so that uninterrupted improved quality seed and planting material supply is made use of. If you look back to the enterprises, dozen plus in these 2 years, enterprises integrated farming system models have been developed. About a dozen organic integrated systems has been developed. Now data on 1 to 10,000 scale is available, which is indeed extremely useful for block level land use plan development. Forget about block level. Do we have district level? Forget about that. Do we have state level? Agriculture, including education, is a state subject. So I'm mentioning only up to state level. So land use plans are absolutely, absolutely essential. And adoption of these integrated intensification of agriculture is the key to bring much needed productivity and enhanced profitability. And therefore, land use plan, for which now data on 1 to 10,000 scale is available, must essentially be researched too. The backward poultry, the poor people, as I mentioned about the egg production, our people have not been lagging behind even in the backyard poultry. And if you look back to Janpriya, Kari Saloni, and Crazy, you may recall those who eat meat, Kadaknath, black meat. Now Saloni, one of the varieties, is in great demand, 2-3 times costlier than the other. So Saloni is another very important development for the backyard poultry. So therefore, even in the backyard poultry, even fortification is not of the varieties only. Fortification is there, and now iron rich, 50% more iron and low cholesterol eggs are available. And NAIP recall contribution, the linseed based product, and where linseed oil is and linseed meal is fed to these birds, reduction has taken place. So not only the fortification, but even the feed has gone a tremendous change. Vaccine. Today we talk so much vaccine. But we forget about our Indian Veterinary Research Institute. There was a time when 95% vaccine of this country used to be produced by Veterinary Research Institute. Even till today, 1920 vaccines are commercialized, developed by these. I recall when H1N1 was a problem, our laboratory worked so hard at Bhopal, within 2 months they brought out killed vaccine. So I salute them, their great contribution. And therefore, this is one of our strength. Now they are, since private sector has come, it is they who are producing, but development of vaccine, their research base is continue to be very strong of Indian Veterinary Research Institute and other sister institutions and universities. Within these 2 years, 10 diagnostic kits have been developed and many more. Therefore, the precise point to drive home is that series of technologies which are available, they are essentially brought to bear on productivity, profitability, and sustainability form. Now, coming to the issues, what is the real problem? What is crux of the whole problem? Why farmers are in distress? They are indeed distressed. I have dealt with Professor Swaminathan's committee report, which is being talked about. C2 plus 50%, it is available. Is it available? The highest increase in food grain was in 2007, 700 rupees to 1900 rupees. Please recall wheat. Now, the question is that when we talk about the very basic price mechanism, I recall somewhere it is 20 times, somewhere 50 times, maybe are 1 to 100 times. Relative increase after independence is gold, 500 times, 5 times more. What about energy? What about human energy? What about labor? What about transportation? What about fertilizers? Despite subsidy, what about pesticides? If you take back and calculate, agriculture is by each passing day is becoming a losing proposition. It is not only the environmental changes. It is not the vagaries and adversities. It is not only the nutritional imbalances. If you look back to Asian report and Indo-Gangetic alluvium, which I was mentioning, on 0 to 9 scale, 0 to 10 scale, vulnerability is 9 of Indo-Gangetic alluvium. Sooner we realize, better it would be. And therefore, the relative price mechanism, agriculture produce vis-a-vis other produce. Now, second most important problem is the retail. This is a basic problem. Farmers purchase everything in retail, all inputs in retail, all his needs and to fulfill his deeds in retail, and he sells in wholesale. That wholesale goes to wholesale market, and from there it goes to retailers, and therefore the consumer pays many times more than what farmer gets. So you will have to address this, despite the fact that in agriculture is a state subject. But without addressing, no venture is flourished for long unless and until it is profitable, doable, and bankable. Now, input chain problems may be little better than what it used to be, but it is one of the weakest link which continue to be. And in this chain, seed, pesticide, fertilizers, spurious seed, spurious pesticide, spurious fertilizers, you can go on and on and on, and exorbitant cost. Therefore, this generic issue will have to be addressed too. Since it is perishable, I have no grudge. Many times I have said that shoes you purchase in the malls under air-conditioned malls, but I will have a grudge if milk, meat, egg, perishables, vegetables are left open, in open, high and dry. We are not a temperate country. We are arid and semi-arid countries where humidity is very high, temperature is very high, relative humidity, you know how much over the seasons. And therefore, you cannot allow this to, and therefore investment is called for. What policy is required? Policy has to be in perspective, whether it is done by public, whether it is done by private, whether they are brought to be a, but reorientation, policy in perspective is absolutely essential. Otherwise, production and technologies would be dancing in isolated islands. Protected cultivation. What is going on? If you see Netherlands, you will see everywhere protected cultivation. That is likely to be as we go along. But today I'm mentioning something, as I mentioned, some generic basic issues I would be raising. I was to Amarnath, and when my coming along these and 7-8 days, I went to Uttarakhand, a few days in Himachal, and I came to a logical conclusion that protected cultivation during the rainy and winter seasons, rainy and summer seasons, protected cultivation, highway scheme, spend substantially, create job opportunities. This is barren area. They are not mutually exclusive. So lot more vegetable, lot more fruits, and lot more pharmaceuticals can be produced. And this is almost 1,000 kilometer long line and water bodies. Much water is going west. So starting from there onwards, as I mentioned, 1,000 area, as I said, inland aquaculture, we are doing remarkably well. We can do it better. But what about the cold water fisheries? 1,000 kilometer long line, northern hills, right from Jammu, Kashmir, going Sikkim down the line. You can produce trout, requires less than 18 degrees Celsius water temperature. It would not survive if temperature is more than 18 degrees Celsius. And here is a clean, green water. And do you know, 700 rupees a kilogram this trout, certainly 2-3 times costlier than other fishes. Can we look to this generic issues and have a lot of wealth? Massive horticultural plantation, the way horticultural plantation are going on, you will, that is why I'm talking of a land use plan in this country. Because out of 328.7 million hectare, 142 million hectare is under agriculture production. We concentrate only there, be it industry or everybody comes over there. In these hill slopes, where up to 45 degree hill slopes are there, you can have wonderful horticulture, wonderful horticultural crops, wonderful plantations. And I believe, and indeed very strongly believe, that there are about 100 million plants which can be brought to different ventures. But ventures on the name of industrialization will come, but they will come only where there are best land. They should go where so-called wastelands are there and incentives should be provided. Massive investment on land development. As I said, 100 million hectare. Invest. 1, 2, 3 million is spent 30,000-40,000 crores each year for coming 30-40 years. Let this land be developed. This will provide livelihood to many people. There are many people who are landless. They could be brought about right from Bhind, Muraina and adjoining areas. Why can't you develop these ravines? Very deep soil, wonderful soils. You will have wonderful production. Even if you do 1 million, can you imagine how much people you can place them? Similarly, massive plantation. We are not Brazil. So that Brazilian model is not going to work for greenery. I did mention how much the intensity on Indian soil, but thousands and thousands and thousands kilometer canal bands, river bands, so many eroded, degraded and bad. Why can't you go for plantation there? But you will not go because I have practical experience. The irrigation people, even irrigation and drainage is not in unison in India. If you look back to Mexico, they are in unison. And the canal people will not allow. They will have 101 problems for plantations. So it will help enormously in the maintenance of bands. At the same time, they will create job opportunities. They will address the concerns of climate change. You are doing wonderful on road constructions. But have you ever calculated? Have you ever planned? Whatever precipitation we are having, we are able to have only about 30% harvesting of that precipitation. Rest all goes with 8 to 10 tons soil per hectare per annum. Please calculate out of 328.7 million hectare on an average 8 to 10 tons of soil going. Have you ever calculated that how many trillion dollars worth nutrient are going and how much problem they are creating? And most, a number of fertilizers, phosphatic and potassic, you are importing. How long, how far? And absorbed cost, prices are going up. How can you sustain? And therefore, this erosion, this degradation and land harvesting will have to be arrested too. And why I mentioned about these roads and the water? In any case, you are using the soil. Why can't you create water bodies? Now JCB machines are available, they are using it. So why can't you make a law that this would be the parameter? Why can't you make a plan that this land would be used so much deep from a place and water bodies would be created and the models developed by ICR and the universities can effectively be used? So not only water harvesting, not only multiple use of water, not only fisheries, but plantations. Horticulture, vegetable, all can thrive there. And with the same money, you can do two things. Similarly, there are enormous eroded, degraded, and barren lands in cold deserts as well as in hot deserts. When I come to hot deserts, right from Rajasthan, right from Gujarat, coming down to Haryana, why can't you invest 10,000, 20,000 crores each year and bring in the plantation of date palm, bring in plantation of bear, and so many arid horticultural crops are available. They will create job opportunities. Even many areas where problems are there, acacia species can be used. So many species, fruits and horticultural crops, they will create enormous job opportunities, enormous wealth and arrest. Similarly, in cold deserts, you can go for many more nutraceuticals and many, many products in these areas where precipitation is as good as nil. Now, if you look back to the integrating issues in eroded, degraded, barren lands, you can create lot of wealth and job opportunities and manage the. In this country, unless and until you address secondary agriculture in right earnest, much needed bankable agriculture would be a far cry. Always this issue persists. Say for instance, soybean. 18-19% soya oil. Our main economy is based on oil. 45-50% protein rich meal. At what cost it is being exported for poultry feed when we are protein, energy, malnourished people? Hexane problem, can it not be removed? We look to the America and other countries many times in US and in Brazil. Soya oil is a byproduct. Soya meal is a main product. In India, soya meal is a byproduct. Soya oil is a main product. Why can't you change? The rain-fed crop. Late Professor Richarya, I would like to pay my homage. What a great scientist. He gave me a book, Wealth from the West, the Lean Seed from Fiber Point of View. Again, written in 1934. So all so-called agricultural West, which is going West, and industrial agricultural West, lot more wealth can be had out of this. And if this plowed back, now the agriculture will become remunerative. And therefore, a planning and investment is absolutely essential to ensure processing, product development, diversified, value-added products, and ensuring much-needed use of so-called agricultural wealth. Now, agro-processing, we have heard a lot. A few agro-processing is going on, but much more is desired, right in the agro-production catchments. Now, as I mentioned, the generic issues, we are talking very high as far as honey is concerned, but we have forgotten. Honeybees are not known for honey. If you look back to the history, 200 years back, in France, honey rearing used to be the order of the day, only to ensure high production of apple gardens in France. So their honey is a byproduct. And therefore, you look a state like Bihar, we started one or two very small and honey was one. And within few years, Bihar became number one state. Honey beekeeping, beekeeping based honey production. Forget about this honey. The very basic cross-pollination. Whether you like or we don't like hybrid culture in agriculture is going to be far more than ever before, where these pollinators would play a very important role. And even in self-pollinated crops, even the rapeseed mustard where I was mentioning, that it is not going to be much affected at least for 15-20 years with these climate change. In Toria, cross-pollination is almost about 40-45%. Even in Junsia, which you cultivate a lot, about 10% cross-pollination do take place. Sunflower, you can go on and on. You can go lychee, you can go mango, you can go a series of fruit and vegetable and agricultural field crops. 15% productivity can substantially be enhanced. And therefore, that is why in a generic issue, I'm mentioning much needed attention is required. Efficient, effective, and relevant land use plan is absolutely essential. We are talking of crop husbandry, we are talking of animal husbandry, but nobody is talking about land husbandry. Land husbandry is one where all gets integrated into. So right from our course curricula to our capacity building to our technology development, and the technology adoption in a land husbandry concept in a land use efficient effective plan is essentially required to be integrated, and therefore lot more changes on this count are required. Bring on board private investment. Bring on board. How? Ways and means will have to be thought about. And we look back how the wealth is going up and how it is being siphoned, policy will have to be in perspective. I recall in 1992, I had an invitation from Toyota from Japan. And the conference was, I was to deliver a lecture, how technology is going to change in Asia and the Pacific. And similarly, people were assigned for different continents. So obviously a private sector, Toyota, a motor company, organizing a conference on agriculture. 8-9 years before the turn of the century, and the topic was how you visualize in 21st century, the agriculture is going to go a sea change. And therefore the obvious question, the reception party on the first day, I asked with the vice president of the company, how come that you are interested in agriculture? He said, Dr. Rai, we want to assess how agriculture is going to go so that we will change our manufacturing for vehicles accordingly. Therefore, industry people must realize, recognize, and appreciate. In the developed economies, people have realized and they have started investing, be it institutes or be it universities, be it funding of research projects. But in India, far and few, hardly a few, and too meager to make much dent. And therefore, it will have to be thought about that industry is not going to go long unless and until agriculture is made strong. Ladies and gentlemen, as I said, I will be raising certain generic issues. A few which I have raised, just and thought-provoking actions. And many of my friends know that I write poetry. And about 10 years back, I wrote a poetry. Aur iska sirsak tha, Bis aur Amrit ka fark yahi hai, kaise use apnaya gaya. Bis aur Amrit ka fark yahi hai, kaise use apnaya gaya. That's the only difference. So if you are open to criticism, constructive criticism, at least if you are open, then probably you will be aching a change and you will be able to make the management of change efficiently or effectively. I trust and believe that the lecture series where many people are expressing opinions would be considered in right earnest by those who are listening, and they will try to think about. I would like to repeat Vivekananda's statement, which I like most, the most in this world is common sense. If we apply common sense, far greater development can take place. Colleagues, friends, ladies and gentlemen, what Buddha say? Buddha said, don't believe what is written. Don't believe what has been taught in the class. And don't believe at all what has been whispered. So obviously you will not believe me what I have said. Because no other than Buddha said. But what he said further? Read carefully. Listen carefully in the class and have an eye on what has been whispered or being whispered, and then weigh it on your own wisdom. And after weighing that, you take right course of action. But if you are servant of thoughts, we must be the servant of action. The major problem in India, despite all the developments, A number of good projects could not see the light of the day, and they were big failures simply because of the fact that we were not ready for constructive criticism and on-course correction. So constructive criticism and on-course correction is the greatest strength on which we essentially need to stand. I trust and believe that finally what Buddha said, Atma Deepo Bhav. Who is doing what is immaterial. Let us ask to the self and let us contribute to the best of our ability so that our people, our farmers, our younger generation are better than what we were. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to recapture. When I was an agriculture student in the early years, and when Lal Bahadur Shastri did mention Jai Jawan Jai Kisan in 1965, my friend, 1962 China War, 1965 another war, and you know Lerma Rozo or Scenario 64, my friends. I recall as a student, it was in this context that levy started, grain used to be taken, and many times forcibly, because there used to be production. The Food Corporation of India bill was passed in 1964, and on 14th January 1965, actually this was put to implementation. And do you know what used to in this war and thereafter what used to be Nara? Ded pav ka ration hai, bada nikamma shashan hai. And you turn the table. You turn the table. Our farmers gave us something so that we are able to keep our head high. We should never forget them. And let us do to the best of our abilities, whatever we can do, so that we continue to be a proud nation and we can keep our head up and high. Thanks and thanks a lot to one and all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for such a exhaustive talk, for giving so many ideas, and in real sense, I can say, for doing this Amrit Barsa, for addressing many issues in agriculture from the core, I can say, it is a really eye-opener for each one of us to understand each of your sentence, and I think you have given the complete scenario of this agriculture, and in true sense, the topic which was assigned to you, the Indian agriculture in perspective. So in true sense, you have done a justice for that. You have given a lot of points. A lot of persons, they are just complimenting your talk in this chat box. But I'll just take one question by Dr. Ramesh Deshpande. And the question is, does India have a well-articulated policy and an action plan to restructure and reform agriculture? How the country should go about? Any suggestion or comments by the Honorable Speaker?
Thank you very much. We have moved with a good speed, and we would also call we had a good velocity. That is the reason we are here as compared to what were there. But policy setting, much more is desired. Plan implementation, much more is called for. Convergence is absolutely essential. The production, processing, storage, consumption has to be seen in unison. Have to be production to consumption mode of operation in a system-wide system perspective with a system-wide system approach, and hence must is desired. One example I would like to mention, oil seeds. As it was brought about, I was officer on special duty on oil seed technology mission. 1.8 million we used to edible oil we used to import. It was brought down to 0.2 million tons. But changes in policy and duty structure, please recall, devaluation of currencies in Indonesia and Malaysia by 30% at that point of time. Single decision I consider. How much we are importing today? Therefore, I would consider 0.6 million hectare, which has been contemplated to be brought about under plantation of oil palm in northeastern state, is a step in right direction. I hope, earnestly hope, trust and believe that quality material would be provided in time, plantation would be restarted in time, and then care would be taken. And till the last, you have to follow, my friend. If there is no master at the fag end, then female flowers would get converted to only male, and this wonderful project would crash. So the project is wonderful, much needed project, in right earnest, in right direction, but implementation is absolutely essentially called for. Therefore, policy in perspective, much is desired, and we essentially need to concentrate at the state and central level much more than ever before.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. May I request Honorable Secretary Dear and DG ICR, Dr. Tirochan Mahapatra, for giving his remarks, Chairman's remarks. Sir, unmute, please. Sir, unmute. Sir, not getting your voice. Sir, your voice is not coming. You can use the other system. You are connected with the two systems.
Can you hear?
Yes, now it clears.
Okay, so thank you very much, sir, for your illuminating talk on many facets of agriculture. And that's what probably was the objective, and that's what was the topic. And we have been enlightened, and I believe many past lectures, for instance, one by Professor R.B. Singh and several others, they have spoken eloquently and also highlighted the issues and challenges. And today you have, in fact, provided many dimensions for us to again examine and then work. Problems are very complex, and then they continue to exist, and rightly highlighted the issues in agriculture, despite the fact that in COVID agriculture is the only area which gave us hope. And it did well, fairly well. That was quite satisfying. And the country's economy and even export. So all taken together. And as you rightly said, providing free food to crores of population who are deprived. So that was very well taken and very rightly said. But the challenges that you have highlighted, sir, they are certainly both, going deeper, having a deeper dive, and then, defining further action plan, as you have also enumerated a number of action points for us. Whether it is degraded soils, as you have said, with regard to micronutrients, with regard to kind of erosion that is happening, the top soils getting lost, and the kind of acidity, soil acidification, which is happening. In fact, we have one lecture on these aspects of Northeast, soil acidification included. And also the kind of issues that is regarding land holding and fragmentation of that, the climate change issues which you have highlighted, the way the decline is going to happen. So very clear terms you have said how this decline is going to happen. So my purpose is not to really revisit what you have said so elaborately, eloquently. You are a wonderful, and so much we learn from you, sir. And my objective is not that, but actually to remind us what you have said and then recapitulate, so that our action plan, what you've said rightly, is rightly formulated, and then all the lectures which are being included or in this Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav series. So the food grain consumption pattern and the way things are happening and the way it is going to happen, and the animal based protein requirement in years to come. So these are all issues for us to actually have detailed deliberation on each one of those. Groundwater is a serious concern, as you have said, the way we are siphoning this water, and over exploiting at least in certain states. In other states, many other states, we are under exploiting groundwater, but in certain states we are over exploiting. So there are all issues which you have rightly pointed out, and several other issues which you have highlighted, and they are worth considering, and we would certainly look into those and analyze further. Sir, as you rightly said, the celebration time is also the time for introspection. And this is a very good statement that you have made. And I believe that all my colleagues will take note of this. And when you are celebrating for more production, then this is the time to introspect. And this is what we are doing. And I think, very rightly said, sir. And one has to really do that. Research intensity has to increase. And you have rightly pointed out, sir, and we have been, in fact, trying hard for this. I had discussion with many others. I will not take names. So we have been discussing that how we can actually do this. And the government investment, and always when we talk of more investment by government, more support by government, so issue comes that how private invest in our research. So both government and private investment has to be actually harnessed. And this is one area, sir, we have not really been very successful in getting private investment into our research. So research intensity is a real concern. And if you want to really increase this, so we need to really build on this. So whatever we have from government, how do we increase to 1% with a little bit more funding from government, and also more of research from funding from private coming in? This is one area needs more discussion, and also greater engagement with the private. And so we would plan a series of meetings on this, sir, and so that our investment from private increases while we are trying to get more funds from government. And if we can get more funding, so that will be very, very useful. So seed conversion rate has been a concern, and there are many dimensions to this issue. And one is that the practice of tendering and getting seeds from the private, and that actually circumvents many things, and and the whole system doesn't really get respected and then used. And seeds which are taken in the form of breeder seed doesn't really get converted to the certified. And the requirements are met through other processes. And that is becoming increasingly visible. And we are trying to actually build a kind of a digital platform along with the Department of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare, that you know, how our bidder seed is flowing to the level of certified, and then how it is getting converted, and you know, that the whole flow to be digitalized. So if that happens, we would have actual idea where we are actually losing out and why, and what should be the corrective measure. Because at this point, exact regions and states where we are actually losing out, so the evidences are very, very limited. So that is one area which needs our attention, and actually we have started working on that. And it will take some time to intensify this and then and put in place in the whole country. Some states are doing better, always as it is. And sir, the other point is that the seed system, almost 35-36% is informal. And that informal seed system is not really very much, in fact, not very much studied. So we are trying to understand that part, because you know, there are the methods of traditional systems and conventional practices of whatever is existing in the farmers' field. And we have not really bothered. For instance, Northeast. So no NSC goes there, and seed supply system is very poor, and traditional systems are still operating. So it's quite a little bit of issues or concerns there, sir. So we are analyzing. I think this also needs far more our engagement and deliberation on addressing the issue of seed. And because you have rightly pointed out how important seed is, and how then the land use plan, sir, the rate at we were moving at which we are moving, it's so slow, sir. You know, it will take another 20-25 years to complete land use plans at the block level, and 1:10,000 scale that you said talked about. So it's a kind of very laborious word. So recently we had a kind of discussion that can we really have some shortcuts, some kind of methods, acceptable ones of course, and where we can actually do this at a lesser time, and what extent will be compromising on quality, that is one issue and still deliberating. But in 5 years, can we really do this plan at block level for the whole country? And this is a big challenge, sir. So I do agree. So with these plans, we should be able to build our future programs, but those plans are not really available at that scale. And so this is a very good issue that you have highlighted, sir, and that needs our attention. Backyard poultry, sir, with new varieties, past 7-8 years, these 6 new varieties which have developed, and the work was going on for a long time. You know, sir, very well, you have supported this program. And the backyard poultry is now getting a boost, sir, and almost 2,000 to 5,000 crore rupees. That's the kind of assessment, 2,000 to 2,000. ₹500 crore, and surplus value and GDP, but also the farmers' incomes that you have highlighted. This needs Syria needs further emphasis and support. The input costs are rising, and then the selling method and the kind of system which is in place doesn't really pay back the farmers. And the new acts, provide some opportunity to sell wherever price is better. But once we accept, implement, right, honest, and implement the e-market system appropriately, and I believe that should be very useful, and the price that we get, and of course what you said is very, very important, what we get in the market, the retail market for the consumers and the farmers marketing system, the pricing system. And I think that's a whole lot to deliberate, sir. I think we have to have separate discussion on this. You know, this is an area because our export is also impacted in the process. Costing that is based on retail price and all that, and we don't become competitive at the global markets, in the process we lose out. And how agriculture can contribute to $5 trillion economy if we don't really address our export issues? The infrastructure funds which are there, sir, the government has brought in, is a good concept, and I hope there will be more of investment in the building of our infrastructure in the storage infrastructure, particularly so that the post-harvest issues, horticulture crops, and all these are addressed, and protected cultivation also is taken care in the country by way of these infrastructure funds being utilized. But then I think not many people understand and know about it. Our KVK system and other things, they have to really talk about it, elaborate. You do that, sir. And so that the youngsters, the farmers, the entrepreneurs actually know about it. What are the provisions and how they can use these funds for building infrastructure for tomorrow, particularly the post-harvesting space, the storage space, and also not only in this sector, even fishery and then animal husbandry, in every sphere infrastructure funds are created. But, you know, as you rightly said, what is actually said and what is actually done, implementation, and always there are gaps, and this is a serious concern. Unless they are implemented appropriately, so obviously, you know, the benefits don't really accrue, as expected. So horticulture needs a massive, our expansion, and but then once the horticulture produce are more, then they are perishable. So we have to have those structures. So 329 million tons are produced, but then our consumption is not happening. The malnutrition is not going. So the consumption, similarly milk, sir, the milk production is high, but consumption is not happening. Per capita availability is quite high. The consumption is not improving. And so malnutrition is still all pervasive. So that area is again a very concerned area, sir. So we need to really work on that, sir. And the government slogan, harvesting rain where it falls and where it falls, it's a beautiful slogan, but it needs implementation. All states have to work on that. And so many programs, on water harvesting, conservation, and utilization through micro irrigation. Micro irrigation is not really moving past us. This is another area of concern. And so despite the thing, the program is there, but it's not being adopted. So there are issues and concerns. So the last two points which you highlighted again, so we had recent deliberation, the secondary agriculture, processing, value addition, at the production site, so agro-processing has to really be given importance, and similarly waste to wealth. So all the points that you have said are so, so important, sir. And certainly there are some areas where government is working, but much more needs to be done. And our own level also, I do see so much to do, sir. And these are all excellent kind of guidance that we receive. Earlier, several occasions, seniors, they have guided us, and today is no exception. And so much we have noted down, and all is recorded, and certainly we will be taking those into account. And as you have cited Lord Buddha's example of what we have to listen, what we have to read, and we have to internalize, we have to analyze, we have to also use our wisdom, and our thoughts should be translated into action after due weighing, and absolutely very rightly said, sir. And we don't take it as a criticism, we take it as a actual illuminating pathways, as earlier also Dr. R.B. Singh did that, and he has been there in all the lectures, sir. And similarly many others have provided quite a number of new ideas and new action points, and we'll work on those. And our farmers have kept our head high, and we must really serve them. And ICR has been doing that. And you have been part of this, service delivered at the farmers' doorsteps. And but it's a big country, number of farmers are so huge. And problems are so complex, region-wise, agro-climate-wise, and all that. So we always, there is room for more work, more improvement, and we'll certainly do that. And lastly, the articulation of policy. In fact, Dr. Prodha Committee has given several recommendations to our Honorable Principal Scientific Advisor. And there are several other fora where the documents are coming out. Policy perspectives are published, and National Academy also brings out those. But we can have a dialogue on policy aspects alone. And if there is a need, and I know certainly there will be many areas which could be gray areas to build further policy formulations and policy advocacy to be in place. And we would certainly plan for that. And Dr. Agrawal, we can actually do that. In fact, NAS forum can be also utilized for that purpose. And Dr. Deshpande also has been attending almost all lectures and giving very good inputs. And we'll certainly would like to have his inputs when we actually go for that kind of program. So we are open, sir, and we will certainly take your advice very seriously and work on that direction. And as I said, when some of the decisions are taken, there are some public perceptions, and that is a serious, whether it is GM or gene editing or even marketing and and many other areas. There are public perceptions and concerns and issues, and that remains an area of concern. How do we change the that aspect and implement the scheme? So the government always is cautious, because any decision taken, if it goes against public, conventional wisdom and then perceptions, so it creates problem, and that we also see in recent times. So that's the reason why that has been in the past, and this is also currently so. So very carefully trading. For instance, the pesticide bill, the seed bill. So they are being deliberated again and again, and then that's still going on. So there are several by private agencies, by others, they are being raised. So they're trying to address. So hopefully they will be all done. So from my side, I profusely thank you, sir, for agreeing to our request and for providing us, many, many new, dimensions and issues, and again, highlighting and providing your guidance. I thank you once again very much, sir. And so with this, I stop here. Dr. Agrawal, back to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir, for nicely summarizing and giving the ICR's viewpoints on the activities which we are doing. So thank you once again, Dr. Mangalaraj Sahab, आपके उजस्वी भाषण के लिए, विचारों के लिए, और आपने जो एक insightful picture एक हमारे दिमाग में create किया उसके लिए. सर ये हर हफ्ते हम जैसा बता रहे थे इस lecture को attend करते हैं, को organize करते हैं. अगला lecture हमारा Dr. C.D. Mai का है, 11 तारीख को 2 बजे, और बहुत ही interesting topic है. Talent search for managing the agriculture tree, and tree means teaching, research, extension, education, and that's what Dr. Mai, who has a long experience, so please keep connected, and we'll see you again on 11th of November for this. And thank you all the audience, esteemed audience, especially I can see many vice chancellors, Professor R.B. Singh, Dr. Ramesh Deshpande, and many more, to name a few, who are regularly attending this lecture series. Thank you again, sir. Thank you and namaskar, sir.